I'm Kohsuke, and so here's he's Jesse Glick, and between two of us, so we've been working on the most part of the workflow plugin in the past few months, you'd say. Yeah. So today, I guess we wanted to go a lot more deep, you know, do the technical deep dive into the workflow plugin. So with that, it's yours. So.
All right. So the problem that we were looking to solve was how to allow you to represent complicated steps in Jenkins. So some people have pretty straightforward needs. Classical continuous integration, you specify that you have a repository, you want to check out from it, you want to run your build script. For a lot of people, this is Maven, could be AntScript, Makefile, whatever it is. You want to go through that whole build until the end, and then you want to see as long as that build step succeeded, you know, finished compiling, didn't have any kind of fatal error, then you want to collect some results, test results, whatever kinds of plugins you might have installed that do some kind of analysis on this, and then that's the end of the job. And it's assumed that everything goes straight through in a linear sequence. If it fails at any point, then that's that. And that works pretty well for a lot of pretty common cases. But we're finding that people had a lot of these more complicated setups where they really had a bunch of different steps that they wanted to run, sometimes in parallel, with different kinds of trigger conditions between them, different conditions for going on to the next step, or sometimes retrying something, or perhaps running some steps on some slave computers and some on others. And it was pretty tricky to set these up in Jenkins. So these are the kinds of harder cases that we were thinking about, multi-stage continuous deployment pipeline, where you're continuing on from a basic continuous integration to where you're running more expensive categories of tests that might run for several hours and possibly require several machines, and then and eventually you might need to have some sort of human approval after a point that, yes, this actually looks good, not just the tests are okay, but I've actually looked at it and there's nothing obviously wrong, I want to push this to production. You might want to run part of the build with some resources locked that you later release, so you might want to fire up a temporary server from a cloud system and use that to run tests against, and then make sure that you're releasing that server back into the pool predictably at a certain point, and then continuing. There are some more interesting scenarios here. I'm talking about blue-green deployment. So you might want to say, I want to do all of these preliminary tests, and then I want to try to push my code up to a production server, but then if something goes wrong partway through, then I want to actually flip everything back and roll back to a previous version of the app. Otherwise, I want to stick with the one I just deployed. Parallel tests, where you want to bring in a bunch of different slave machines to try to split up a really big test workload into a bunch of little pieces that can each run in a few minutes. And you don't know ahead of time necessarily how many of these you're going to need to have, but you want to kind of shard all of your tests across a bunch of different machines and collect all of the results.
Right, so in other words, like, you know, we started thinking originally as like a continuous delivery pipeline problem, but as we generalized this a little bit more, we sort of started realizing that this is not just buzzword compliance, it's actually solving a very useful everyday problem that many people would fit outside the context of software delivery pipeline. So these are some of these use cases.
So we tried to collect a list of characteristics of the kinds of jobs, or we'll call them workflows for lack of a better term, that people might have that that had bigger requirements than you could necessarily get with a simple project in Jenkins. So the first I was talking about is complex pipelines, multiple stages of things that have to go in a certain order and that you want to divide up into stages but still have a logical sequence. Non-sequential logic, so if you want to have things that run in a loop several times, if you want to do the same activity a certain number of times depending on some variable which is pulled in from some part of your source code, from some part of your environment, that has to be supported. Long-running builds is a pretty important thing that people run into a lot, but you might not think about it first. So this is the fact that if you have a build which is taking more than, 20 minutes or so, you would really like it to keep on going even if something happens to Jenkins. So if Jenkins crashes and you have to bring it back up, or you just want to update a plugin and restart Jenkins in the middle, or if the slave if you lose the connection to the slave computer, but the slave is still okay, it's still running your build, but your network connection to it just dropped off temporarily and then reconnects. When these things happen, you would like to have your build survive all of those kinds of temporary problems, keep on running. Interaction with humans, you want something that deals well with people, so if you want to let people approve a particular version of software before it moves on, then that has to be represented somehow. Restarting builds, we'll try to do a demo of this, but if something goes wrong very late in a really lengthy, difficult build, you don't necessarily want to have to restart the entire thing from the very beginning. You'd like to start just from the last safe point. And the last two about reusable definitions and comprehensible scripts, people would rather have the logic of these workflows that they're doing sort of all in one place with a clear script that you can look at and see what it's doing without having to go to different GUI pages to see what things are doing without having to copy configuration from one place to another.
Yeah, and I think the other part of this is that in the large enterprise, what we see is there's like a separation role going on. There are a small number of teams that define the build processes and otherwise things that the product team would have to follow. And then the product team would take it and then sort of use it with a small minor modifications or parameter filled in, like where is my repository, like which kind of test framework I'm using. So there are this central team would basically dumb down, create rather elaborate abstractions, and then we want the product team to be able to use it without getting them exposed to all the gory details. So I think that's part of making the script comprehensible by creating the means of reusing these pieces. So you can hide the build engineering team could hide all the gory details and still expose a rather neat packaging to the users.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially in big organizations with a lot of teams that have products with the same kind of structure that you want to impose a common process on all of them, but each of them have their own software sources and a few little tweaks they want to add to that as well. So
today, back to this, the typical continuous delivery pipeline that people might be doing today. And as I talked to you earlier this morning, you can do this today, but what it would look like is this like a whole bunch of different jobs, right? But now, one of the key aspects of the workflow is, I said, that to do this in the single job. So let's look at how we do this in one job definitions.
Sure, so I can just give an overview of what this is. This is a pretty small, but not smallest possible workflow. So this is as far as I know, this is a valid script here.
Yeah.
We start off at the top line saying that we want a slave node, and we can specify what kind of node we want to run on. So we can say this should be Linux. You can also give it other kinds of labels. You can say, you know, Windows and 64-bit or something like that. Once we have a slave and we have a workspace on it, within these outermost curly braces, everything that happens happens on that slave. We'll just check out some code from Git, and then we'll run a shell step. So we'll just run some command of your choosing. In this case, we're just calling Maven to build. And then the fun part is we're using this parallel keyword to do two different things simultaneously. And so I give branch names for each of them, which we can use to identify things in the user interface, but otherwise have no meaning. And each of those, you can see that there's more curly braces. This is a block of code. And each of those is running some other shell steps. So this is running two different external programs, your regression tests and your performance tests in parallel, in this case on the same workspace.
So let's go to the next one. I guess aside from the fact that this is a text, what does this enable us? We could use this old familiar programming language construct to build out the abstraction of the complex flows, right? Today in the freestyle project, you'd have to use a dedicated plugin to create this like a conditional ifs and else kind of workflow.
I think there is a conditional build step.
Yes, conditional build step plugin. Well, here it's like you already know how to do that. Another, I think, common thing people want to do is to make sure that the things get cleaned up after running something. You know, you deploy the server, run the load test, and at the end you want to make sure that the things are shut down. Again, in the programming language, we already know that the idiom to do that. So all these, obvious like concept, everyday concept we need is sort of like a very concisely expressed in this one, text file. I think the another key part of this is that while the workflow is executing in the middle, well, we could, while the workflow is executing in the middle, we could still restart this workflow, the virtual machine that's running it, which is a bit odd if you think of, if you think of the execution of this as a single thread running through all this program, which is basically how it gets executed. Well, we can't just shut down the VM and expect the program to resume, right? So that's one of the key innovations in the behind the scene that happens this. In all this workflow script, every function call you see, that's something useful. And then those are fairly low-level primitives. For those of you who have seen the build flow plugin, you already know that the build flow plugin does something similar, except the minimum primitive there is to be able to invoke other jobs. So you'd have to still define the interesting parts in other jobs. You're only using build flow to choreograph this. In this case, in this workflow plugin, however, you can do every primitive operation that you can do in Jenkins and combine them in very flexible manner. So we can get the new slaves allocated, we could check out the new code. So you can very easily check out from multiple sources, and you just need to make function call twice or three times. So that's how we could sort of mix all these building blocks inside Jenkins into a very flexible form, and then that's how we chose this text-based DSL. Another reason I guess we are doing this inside as a text file is because we like over time we really started liking our professional started liking putting things into the version control system, managing them as a program. So, since we are describing this to the text, it's kind of obvious that we want to put this workflow inside the source code repository. So, we thought of number of ways to let people do it, and then providing a few ways right now. So the first one is, if you're interested in having this workflow script residing in the same repository as your source code, kind of like your build script is, then you could totally do it. You can just put whatever, like a Groovy script in the, maybe Jenkins.Groovy or whatever name. And then inside Jenkins, all you're telling Jenkins to do is, I need to run somewhere, and then this is where my source code is. And then once you load the script, just execute this workflow script, right? So that's very obvious, hopefully. And then, you know, the whatever logic you have, you know, running tests in parallel, you know, all sorts of stuff can go into this script, and then you already know how to version control those. And if you're creating a branch, you could modify those. So you get all the benefits like that. And there's a second one that's useful. It's bit for catering for a bit of a different audience. If you have a lots of products that's sharing the similar workflow script, then you want to be able to reuse them. And then so in that case, you know, the putting this into the version control system, putting it into the same version control system as the source code repository, like what I showed you in the previous slide, doesn't work very well. So in this case, for the second use case, we added this the Git repository inside Jenkins that you can talk through its web UI. Its HTTP UI or the SSH server. This is one of a best known secret in Jenkins functionality. And then so you could push whatever Groovy workflow script into this Git repository. And then that entire sort of directory flow of Groovy files is made available as a sort of like a class path, if you may, to the workflow script that you're writing inside the job. So what this means is that if you have this in this Git repository, if you have a file called org/acme/my-workflow.groovy, and then if it contains like a fragment of these workflow code we just showed you earlier as a functions and classes, then inside the GUI of Jenkins, this is all you have to do. And then basically saying, I'm going to use this workflow definition that I have. And then I'm passing on the necessary contextual parameter, and that's it. Now, this particular syntax, I think it's got some room of improvements, but I hope you get the idea that there is like one repository in Jenkins that you can push the workflow script into, and every job could use it. And since it's a Git repository, you could obviously version control these things. So, you know, if you're creating this workflow that's shared by many product teams, you probably want to do the proper staging and production and all that stuff. So now you already know how to do that stuff, right? All you have to do is to eventually to push the Git repo so you can do the branching and have another Jenkins instance to test out and whatnot. So yeah, I think it's very powerful notion. So the next one I want to talk about, which is I think in the keynote slide I mentioned about, I think I had this animation that, you know, well, when we didn't want to disrupt the workflow execution while Jenkins gets restarted. So but if you think about it, it's a bit of a magic. So to really drive the point home that this is the degree of magic involved, what I wanted to talk about is, you know, so let's say, look at this hypothetical script where you're calling a function, which is, you know, not really doing anything useful right now, just sleeping for an hour. But like, think of this as some real build. And at the end of it, you kind of want to do some cleanup. So imagine that while this is running here, your Jenkins, you shut down the Jenkins and bring it back again. So what happens is, you know, this program, from this program point of view, you didn't even notice that the Jenkins went down. And when it comes back up, and then sleep is still running on that sleep process. And when it's over, it'll come right into this finally block. And all your function calls, stack, and local variables, and whatever, is left intact. So that's sort of how we sort of hide away this like a detail, if you may, from the workflow script. To do this, what we do internally is basically, I think the most succinct way to describe this is, you know, we basically wrote a custom Groovy interpreter. Right, so we look at it, you know, we use the compiler to get the AST built, and then we execute them in the format otherwise known as the continuation passing style, which is, you know, what exactly does, it's not particularly relevant for those people, those of you who don't know what it is. If you know what it is, then I guess you might have like a chuckle, like, okay, finally, what I learned in the computer science school, this is like, okay, I'm finally being useful. But the general idea is like, you know, it captures this like execution call stack explicitly and maintain them. And then so whenever we need to hit, we hit these pause points, like we forked off the process and now we are not doing anything until that process comes back, we basically takes that entire state of the program and then serialize those onto the disk. So we have, you know, some particular internal details about how to persist objects that otherwise difficult to persist, like you know, the fact that it's occupying the slave at the time and so on. So that's where a lot of plumbing has to happen between the core and Jenkins, and that's where Jesse spent some you know, a lot of time earlier this summer, I think. But you know, those are basically, at this point, I think it's safe to say that it's kind of done. And then so the end result from the user's point of view is that it sort of more or less just works. You see the workflow program run from the beginning to execution, even though the virtual machine session might be different in between. The only, I suppose, the visible part is the fact that the workflow script kind of needs to be serializable, as in Java I/O serializable kind of deal. And then so that it's, if you really start to do, you know, there are some, if you really start to do complex things in the workflow, that would be the problem. But then so long as you keep this to, you know, the general act of like a choreographing primitives that we provide in the workflow plugin, I think this restriction shouldn't be too much of a problem. So that's that. And I guess so in case this isn't obvious, you know, like I said, like we are really trying to build this like a one plugin that would be able to rule them all. It's like you the kind of things people do today by putting together things like you know, the env inject plugin or the parameterized trigger plugin and all that stuff is all should be all doable in the workflow plugin. So that's our goal. Do you want to do this for me?
Sure. So as part of Jenkins Enterprise by CloudBees, we also add a few things on top of workflow. So we definitely, the workflow that's in Jenkins Enterprise, Jenkins Open Source on GitHub is self-contained, and most of what we are demoing will be from that. There are a couple things that we're adding in Enterprise Edition. The two main things are ability to resume from a checkpoint. So this is something that's mainly valuable if you have a pretty long-running thing. You probably aren't going to care too much if your build takes 20 minutes, but some of our customers have builds that, for whatever reason, they take 32 hours. And so what you don't want is to have your build go for 31 hours and do all of this stuff and do extensive testing, and then at the last moment, just as it's about to, you know, send something off to the production server, like the, you know, you have a DNS error or something, and that step fails, and then you have to go and restart everything. So we added a feature that lets you put in safe points that you can restore from to prevent that. And another thing that we're doing is adding in richer visualization of the results of workflow runs that go beyond the kind of view of build history that you would get for regular projects. So we'll take a look at that as well. So should we switch to a demo? Let's see.
By the way, this demo that we're going to show, it's packaged as a Docker image, and I think it is available on the workflow plugin, right? So if you go to, we will show the URL later, but if you wanted to play that with yourself, you can run it inside the Docker container, and you know, it comes with all the sample script that you could play with. So we'd love to have you try that out.
Yeah, so somewhere on this page, probably not very well advertised. Yes, you're very, the very bottom. Should probably edit this.
That's how you know you're engineers, right?
There is a Docker demo. I'm running a demo that includes the Jenkins Enterprise features, so most of it is going to look identical to the Jenkins CI demo. There'll just be a couple extra things I'll point out. So here we have a workflow that we've called CD. This is just you can create one of these just like you would any job in Jenkins. So it's a new option rather than freestyle project or something like that. And if we go to configure it, you'll see that the configuration screen is pretty simple. It has some familiar stuff if you're already a Jenkins user, like you can set parameters and build triggers and things that happen before the workflow runs, ways of starting it. But then when it's actually running, let's switch to that, then it's then there's not much here. So in this case, we're just saying that we're going to load all of the actual body of the flow from the Git repository that we're checking out here.
And then open the notepad or something so that I could blow this up.
Yep, so. So here is the actual flow script that we have. So first it starts off doing some development and basic code analysis type things here. So in this first line, I'm setting up some tools. So this could be running on any slave that hasn't been pre-configured. So right off the bat, I want to make sure that we have the right versions of our tools installed. So this little snippet suffices to say that if I've configured a Maven installation called 3.x on my Jenkins instance, that I can get access to it. And this is just a Groovy function that returns the installation location of Maven after possibly downloading it onto the slave and installing it for you.
Right. You might have been already using this functionality in regular Jenkins to auto-install tools, so this happens automatically.
Right. So if you were using a Maven project type or a Maven build step, then you would select this and it pull down. Here, we can just assign it as the value of a function call. So if you want to have two different Maven installations and run two parts of your build, one with old Maven, one with Maven 3, then there's no special trick to it. You just assign it to different variables. Here I'm also using a special variable called env. This just sets environment variables for the rest of the build. So I want to make sure that any other processes that I run from this include this version of Maven in the path. Stage dev, this sort of gives a label to everything that follows and says that this is part of my development part of my build, or sort of a standard CI section, I guess you could call it. And we'll see a more interesting variant of that a little bit later. And then we're going to run a basic Maven build. And then the archive command takes a file that we've produced in our workspace and sends it back to the master and archives it. So unlike a freestyle project where archiving is always at the very end of a build, here you can archive anything you want at any time during the build, whenever it makes sense. Then we move into a new stage for, we'll call it QA. It's not exactly QA, but we'll call it that. And here again, we'll use parallel to do a couple things in parallel. One set of tests will run in this example for 30 seconds. One will run for 20 seconds. And here we're taking advantage of Groovy to make this script simpler. So we're down here, we've defined a function. There's run with server. It takes a body, so this is a Groovy block of code.
Closure
between curly braces. And then we're just running some custom code. So we're just doing some calculation. We're going to create a random string, a random UUID. We're going to call another function. This deploy is going to send a WAR file off to a Jetty server. Here we're just doing everything on one machine, but normally it would be using SFTP or something like that. We're deploying it under a particular name, and then we're going to call back into our method with the URL where this application is now running in Jetty. And then whatever happens in this, whether it succeeds, fails with some kind of weird error, we're always undeploying it at the end, so we never leave extra servers lying around.
So hopefully you see the value of building abstractions and subroutines in this way. You can compose a mundane or complicated task into something easily reusable. Right? That's inherently, instinctively, that's what we do with programs. But in the workflow, I think the same thing applies.
Yes. And then we're going to move into a staging step. And here I say concurrency one. What this means is that even if a bunch of developers are all pushing commits into the Git repository, it can run all of the preceding stuff in parallel. So it can run tests on all of their builds in parallel. But I only want to have one actual change moving through a staging pipeline at once. So I want to throttle that down to a single one at a time. And then we'll deploy it to a staging server, ask for human approval. So this input step just sits there and waits for a person to, or a script using a REST API or something to say, yes, go ahead, or no, stop now.
And here you could, for example, tie it to the access control so that you can restrict who could approve this. And in this case, I think you're just asking yes or no answer, but you could actually get some input value. Like, you know, you can ask people to type in that string or upload a file or whatever.
Or, yeah, give me a URL to deploy this to or something. And now we'll try to run a checkpoint. So this demo works with or without Jenkins Enterprise. So the checkpoint is going to keep track of everything that happened up until this point. And sort of save a copy of it, and we'll see that. And then finally, if everything is looking good, then we're going to try to go into production. Here we grab a different workspace to run builds on, not on the slave. This could be on a different slave, whatever you like. First, we're doing a sanity check, make sure that the server is alive before we try to deploy it. And then I pick up our WAR file and deploy it and print out a message. So let's see all this stuff running. So I go to build now, and we'll go to the Jenkins overview. You can see that there are actually two items here. The CD number one is the flow itself, the logic. It's not consuming any executor. It's just running in the background. And then this part of CD number one is the actual work that's running on a slave. So this is actually consuming executor number two in the slave because it's doing real stuff. So you see some output going on. Before we get too deeply into it, I'm just going to restart Jenkins right now. And keep your fingers crossed.
It's the moment of truth.
Oh, Jenkins is restarting, and I'll show you some output to prove that that's real.
So I guess you can think of this as a simulated Q-9, right? It's for override the process, right? Yeah. It's another image.
So. It comes back up, still going here. No apparent harm done. If you probably didn't notice that anything was out of the ordinary here, but if you look carefully, you can see that at some point in the middle of this, resuming build meant that this is where it came back from after the restart. So it's pretty much transparent. This is the only indication that Jenkins restarted in the middle of all that. So it ran all of our tests and everything was fine. And it's asking me, so you see that up here, it temporarily deployed two different copies of this application to various other servers. It cleaned them up afterwards. This is now a 404 because it undeployed them at the end. And now it's saying, I've got a staging version of this. So does this application look good to you? Sure. So we could choose to proceed to deployment or abort. I'm going to make this break. So here's the ugly part. Right? So we're going to go in here, and I'm going to, it's usually number 12, I'm going to kill off my Jetty server. So in the middle of this complicated stuff. My Jetty server died, but I don't know that yet. So I'm going to proceed and see what happens. And oops. So I tried to proceed, but then it said, well, I did my sanity check before deploying, and oh, it looks like Jetty was dead, so it's not going to work.
So our deployment had failed, even though the bits were good.
The bits were fine, but there was just a transient problem. Here I've restarted Jetty, so now actually it's back up again. So what do we do? So we can go up to build number one. You see that it failed, but there's this little link checkpoint, since this is part of the Jenkins Enterprise feature, that you have this checkpoint right before production, and we're going to restart from there. And so this kicks off a new build, number two. And when you go to number two, it's just going to restart where it left off in number one, except this time it's going to work because the server was back up, and so yeah, it actually finished deploying.
So we didn't have to reboot the binary or do any of the audio steps.
So this was a lot quicker than number one. And the other bit in Jenkins Enterprise is visualization of different stages of this flow into a kind of table that you get automatically. This is still very early, so there's some bits of information missing from this, but the idea is that you could go and look into details of particular stages and compare them, and we'll be adding little quick ways to do things like accept input or restart from checkpoints from different flows that are within this. And
right. So we started thinking like what people would care about these, you know, the showing, the knowing about how the workflow has been run. So we already have, like, if you go to the specific build page, you can see how each step has executed and whether they succeeded and not, and all that stuff. So that's already available, and this is part of open source, right? If you want to, like, summarize that information, what's important? So we think one of the key information is, like, how much time your, you know, job is taking between different stages, like, how much time you're spending in the QA phase, or how much time you're spending waiting for the, like, approval to come in. So that's sort of like, you know, the insight got into this view. So that's why we think the time information is the key part. And we also wanted to keep this part rather clean, but we also wanted to provide access to more details. So that's why when you hover mouse around, you see all these access to the logs, or the, if you have artifacts, that you provide the link to the artifacts. If there is a failure, yeah, you get to see the cause of the failure right away. So we try to sort of put the information closer to you when you need it. So that's part of the visualization effort that's going on.
Yeah. I just want to mention one other thing that we added pretty recently. So to make it easier for you to discover how to write this stuff, you can write a complete flow in the Jenkins UI, or you can keep a flow definition in your version control, which is probably more suitable for bigger, more complex scripts like this. But of course, the question is how you know that you're supposed to write archive rather than save or something like that. So what are the commands that are available and what's the syntax for all of them? So we'll be thinking about other options in the future, but for the short term, what we have is something that just basically lets you pick any of the available build steps using a GUI configuration. So for example, archive artifacts, you can say, I want to include, you know, all jar files, and just click generate Groovy, and it will tell you the name of the command and how you pass those particular arguments to it. So if you want to include all jar files except for stuff in the ignored directory, then it would tell you the syntax for that as well. And so this is a good way to learn how to write scripts and get some suggestions about things that can do. This list is generated on the fly based on the plugins you have installed and what build steps are available. So, and some of these have some more inline help so you can get more information about the particular step and so on.
And I think where this really gets useful is, so part of this workflow effort was about providing the interop with existing build steps. So, you know, we have already version control system. So when we wrote this like a Git function, it was actually coming from the Git plugin. And you already know that the Git plugin has like a gazillion configuration options, right? So we provide access to those, but I guess that would come from general SCM, I suppose. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So and then you could sort of, you know, configure those in the GUI.
Doesn't fit very well in 10.4/768.
But yeah, you can, you know. So this is the same configuration snippet that you see in the freestyle project, and then you can type it in, and this snippet generator helps you like get the bits out. Mm-hmm. And in the future, we also wanted to do like an IDE auto completion script and so on. We know how to do that, but that's the kind of thing you're working on to help you write. It works so more easily.
Yeah. So if you want to go overboard with lots of advanced Git configuration, it will generate all of the stuff that you need.
Right.
You can pick out, you can delete parts of this that are the defaults or that you don't care about, and just pick the important parts if you want to customize the behavior.
Yeah, this is a part of open source Jenkins, if that's what you mean, is that right?
It came for free after several days of work. right. Yeah. So this. Yeah. All of this configuration UI is coming from the stock Git plugin.
Right.
And there's no special code to handle the Git plugin here.
Yeah. Let's see. How much time do we have here?
Should we switch back to slides? Is there something else you want to show?
No, I think let's switch back to slide and
okay. QED. There are a bunch of things that are definitely missing and that we plan on adding over the next few months and who knows years. One thing that's probably pretty high on the priority list is interactive workspace management. So right now, unlike a regular Jenkins freestyle project, you can get as many workspaces as you want on any kinds of slaves within the same build. The downside is that we don't yet have a function to browse some of those workspaces because the standard stuff in Jenkins doesn't cover that possibility. So we're going to have to build something that shows you a list of all the workspaces that you use during this build and lets you browse into them to help debug failures and that sort of thing. A lot of robustness that we need to clean up. It's actually getting pretty good, I think. We managed to restart without any issues. That's always the hard part.
But there
will be a lot of bug fixing. So as people get to use this more and more, we'll expect to hear about corner cases that didn't work right the first time and fix those. And the UI is very rough right now. It's just the minimum that we could get to work while we worked on features. But we hope to get that improved. There's a lot more we're using Trello right now for tracking it, but I think we'll be moving to the Jenkins issue tracker once we have more people involved and we have a 1.0 release.
Right. So this plugin, you know, as you can see in the URL, it's open source, and the code is all out there. And if you're interested in helping us, not by just writing code, but actually by putting it to the use, we'd love to hear from you. We wanted to see the production kind of workflow, what kind of the complicated workflow people need to handle with these sort of things. JC released the 0.1 beta 5. Now that I think of it, 0.1
that's an
doesn't
intentionally scary number.
Doesn't carry the level of confidence we have in these bits. But so it's usable and it's installable. And this requires a fairly new version of Jenkins because we've been making a lot of changes in the core to make this workflow plugin possible. But the good news is that this 1.580 is the base version for the next LTS. So the LTS that's going to come out next week is going to be able to run the workflow plugin. And as we demoed, I think we've been focusing on getting all the fundamentals right, that is all the abstraction, the APIs, the language syntax, the CPS execution engine, that sort of stuff. And I think that's really getting up into the good shape. We are aiming for the 1.0 next month, so probably like a later November. So Jesse and I are very excited about this effort, and we are hearing lots of good feedback. So I had a lot of conversation about this functionality today in the hallway. And I think this club is recognized as a very important technology to move Jenkins forward. So, we are spending a lot of efforts between among us. So to wrap it up, yes, so you know, workflow is here. It kind of works. It's really simplified the complicated, you know, the workflow orchestrations. It lets you define everything in a single job as a text file in ways that you know how to handle. And it survives the, it helps you run for a long time, survives the IBM loss, and it even helps you interact with humans. And as with everything else in Jenkins, it's highly extensible. So it, like the next phase of the, I think the development involves encouraging the plugin developers in the community to build on top of it. So I think that's the slides that we prepared. So if you have any questions, I think we'd be happy to answer.